Welcome to Private for Public, a deeper look at Maine's delicate and often complicated tradition of public access to private land, brought to you by the Maine Department of Inland Fisheries and Wildlife. Hey everyone, this is episode 2 of Private for Public. I'm your host, Chris McCabe, and this week I'm talking with landowner Doug Duren, who's joining me virtually from his 430-acre legacy farm in Wisconsin. Doug is the founder of the Sharing the Land Initiative, a movement that is redefining the relationship between hunters, landowners, and nature.
My name is Doug Duren. I live in Cazenovia, Wisconsin, which is in southwest Wisconsin's Driftless area, which is an area that the glaciers didn't hit. And so it's a very sort of hilly topography that has been formed by erosion, not eruption, as mountains are. And I'm a landowner here, 120-year legacy farm that my family owns. I'm this generation's manager of that property. It's 430 acres, and in our part of the world, 430 acres is a lot of land. I have to say that I spent a big part of the 1980s in New Hampshire and Maine. I actually was a high school teacher in Gorham, New Hampshire, from 1985 to 1990, and in 83 and 84, I was out there for the summers. Actually lived in Boston with my, chasing a woman, and we ended up getting married. But so I lived in Boston. That was my introduction to New England. So I actually spent a lot of time up there on the border of Maine and New Hampshire, by Gilead, Maine, Sunday River area, spent a lot of time in the Presidential Range, and then over in the Rangeley Range in Maine. I got useless in Eustis, as the bumper sticker says. I'm sure there's still a car in a salvage yard there somewhere with that bumper sticker on it, a car that we had at the time. So I'm very familiar with at least that part of Maine. I spent a fair amount of time down east also. And then when I moved back here to the Midwest, where I'm originally from, did a few trips out there, including some bicycle trips down east, and even went all the way up to Lubeck and the easternmost point in the United States. And one of my favorite shows out there when I lived out there was I don't know if it's still on. So you think you know Maine still on out there?
No, it's no, that's not on anymore. That was a good one. I do remember that back in the day, though.
Yeah. That was hilarious. But anyway, so that's my story. I'm from Wisconsin, but I spent a lot of time out there. And through the work that I've done in conservation and the outdoors, I did trail work actually when I in the summers when I was a teacher out there in the on the north slopes of the Presidential Range. I lived in Randolph, New Hampshire there for a while, and God, I just love that area. There's nothing like northern New England.
Yeah, so you're very familiar. I mean, having that connection to Maine, and one of the things like that drew me to your initiative is that obviously in Maine we have a lot of private land, similar to what you talk about on Sharing the Land, where you talk about the area that you live in, where in Wisconsin that 94% of it's privately owned, and that is the state of Maine. 94% of this is privately owned here, with large parcels of land owned by paper company, large forest product companies. And when I saw, I think the first time I saw you and heard about your initiative was, I think you were taking some young hunters out, or Joe Rogan or some of those guys out hunting. I saw you on the Meteor show. And then kind of like moving forward, kind of followed where you had that Sharing the Land initiative. And I really can appreciate that, where you're a landowner yourself, like you said. You own a large parcel of land in Wisconsin, and truly are a hunter and conservationists, but also understand that users are looking for a place to hunt.
Yeah, it's been a really interesting ride for me the last 15 years. You know, I met Steve Rinella as a result of reading his book, A Scavenger's Guide to Haute Cuisine, and then quickly followed up with American Buffalo. And I sent the guy an email, and he wrote me back. I didn't actually send it to him. I sent it to the publisher, and he wrote me back. And a conversation ensued, and then we became friends. And then, you know, whatever it was, 11 or 12 years ago when Meat Eater took off, I kind of got pulled along in the vapor trail, you know. Vortex Optics here from Wisconsin, Barneveld, Wisconsin. I've known those folks since they were a real small company, and now they're really pretty much the biggest optics company in the world. And I introduced them and Steve, and they worked out an arrangement. And the next thing you know, Steve's calling me up and saying, "Hey, man, can we come to your place and do a hunt and video it?" And yeah, I said, sure. And I've just been there as a result of being, you know, a friend of his. I've been there, you know, sort of as a part of the Meat Eater family, not so much as the Meat Eater team. But as a result, I've gotten to highlight some pretty interesting things. Steve's been really generous with his time for highlighting things like an initiative that I used to be involved with, which was a private land forestry initiative called My Wisconsin Woods. And he helped us promote that. He's helped us promote the Driftless area. And when he talked to me about, the first time I met Steve, he came to the farm, and we no more than got to the farm, and he goes, "Hey man, is there anything I can help you with around here?" I mean, that's the kind of guy that, you know, that he is. Having grown up in the Midwest, he grew up in Michigan. He understood the value of private land access, and one of the best things that you can do for the kind of private land access seeking that you're doing in an area here is to be cooperative and helpful, right, with the landowner. Very different than those large parcels that you have out there in Maine that belong to the paper, or maybe it's not. I mean, you can tell me about that. Northern Wisconsin has a little more of the kind of land that I remember when I lived out there, where it's, you know, big parcels owned by now by real estate investment trusts, REITs, or paper companies or whatever. But I think the pressures are still the same. I mean, you know, access has value, right? I mean, access to private land has value. And the cost of private land has, in our part of the world, skyrocketed. And so we've worked pretty hard to figure out a way to allow access and do something good for the land. And that's what sharing the land is really about.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I could see like similarities. I mean, we talk about Maine being a little different, like on the landscape, where we probably don't have the population or the amount of hunters that you do, but we see it on our end, where that's why our department has two game wardens that are assigned to landowner relations, so that we can go out and help the landowners with issues that they're having. We can go address those issues. And one of the things that you do very well, Doug, with your initiative, I feel, is getting that word out there that hunters, or just access seekers in general, whether you're a fiddleheader, whether you're a forager, any type of thing like that, where you are accessing people's private land, you get out there and make that known that it's not free. The landowner pays for it, and it's only beneficial to the landowner and for the hunter or anybody to help them out and give them some type of reward for their return.
Yeah. We talk about the three C's in my initiative: community, cooperation, conservation. One of the, because we're dealing with a kind of a smaller parcels. And when I say private landowner here, it's, you know, private individuals, not companies. And so what we have found with sharing the land is that engaged landowners, a lot of whom in our area are absentee owners, which is a recent phenomenon. And when I say recent, being my age, that's, you know, the last 30 or 40 years. They're engaged with their property. They want to do good things from a conservation standpoint. I have a land management consulting business, and most of my clients are absentee owners. And one of the things that they learn very quickly is that owning and managing a piece of property is a lot of work. I've had a lot of landowners say to me, geez, I bought this property and it seems like all I do is come up here and work on it. And, you know, I was hoping to come up and relax and just hunt and, yeah, to get time for hunting and stuff. But so, you know, having this platform of working with Ranella, seeing the changes in access. When I was a kid, I could go anywhere. I remember the first person who posted their land around here. And then the neighbor who then, it was a guy from away, from Milwaukee, and he put up these no trespassing signs. So we were like, what the heck is this? And then his neighbor who very quickly put up a no trespassing signs that said, if your land is posted, stay the hell off of mine. You know, that's that sort of local sensibility, right? But then seeing that, and then that becoming more and more common, and then landowners needing this, and the land needing us, right? And that's sort of that Aldo Leopold ethic, the land ethic, that managing our property or doing the best for it is important. And again, in our part of the world, a little bit different than out there in those big expanses in parts of Maine, man, this is heavily manipulated land, right? Big agricultural land. And as soon as you, as I tell a lot of my clients, as soon as you decide that I'm not going to manage this property, we're just going to let nature take its course. Well, doing nothing is a management strategy. It's not a very good one. Invasive species take over. In our case, white-tailed deer are out of control. There are all of these sort of, when I say out of control, high populations of white-tailed deer. And as you may know, we also have a growing issue with chronic wasting disease. All of those things coming together, landowners need help. The land needs us. Access is becoming more difficult. So, and then me having this platform, all of those things came together and it just made sense to come up with something like sharing the land, you know, which is really defined as it's a network. It's a conservation cooperators network, and we connect landowners with private land access seekers and hunters. You know, you mentioned fiddleheaders. Never quite heard it referred to as that. I never knew what a fiddlehead fern was before I lived out there. But man, I spent a lot of spring mornings catching breakfast brookies and picking fiddlehead ferns. You're bringing up some great memories for me.
Yeah, I mean, definitely we've seen it here, like you were talking about land expense and land changing hands. And really we talk about Northern Maine being the larger paper company land, what we refer to the larger forest products like the North Maine woods and stuff. But Southern Maine and down East Maine, where you kind of were referring to earlier, we have seen a change in the last couple of years, and especially since COVID. Land ownership has changed. We've seen more posted signs come up. And that's really, like, I was very fascinated by your perspective out there, because we're kind of on that early fringes of what you guys see. When you were talking about when you were a kid and that landowner posted his land and then the other one posted their land, that if your land's posted, that you're not going to be able to access mine. Yeah. And really, we're kind of in that early stages of that with the change in land ownership. And it's pretty...
That's interesting.
Yeah, it's very interesting, like, hearing you say that and see where we are now.
Well, and I think there's a big... Correct me if I'm wrong on this. I recall having read some of about what you guys are talking about and then having been out there. And then I think Meat Eater covered a controversy out there about bear hunters or something. So in Wisconsin, if you don't have permission to be on a piece of property, you are trespassing. Whereas there's implied permission out there, right?
Correct.
It used to be like that here. It used to go like that, like Bob Dylan said, it used to go like that. Now it goes like this. And so that was switched over, I don't know how many years ago, maybe 40 years ago. But what happened is that people were posting, you know, putting up no trespassing signs, these rules that you had to have one every 100 yards and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And you know, and then people would just go and tear them down.
We talk about that for sure. It's what we would refer to as reverse posting, which we don't have here in Maine. Like you said, it's implied that you have access to property unless you're told or it's posted not to. And definitely one of the things that we've seen is that, and it's come up in the last several years about Sunday hunting. We're one of the only states in the country that doesn't allow Sunday hunting. But also at the same point, from our perspective, we look at it as it's a fair compromise with the landowners. We talk about compromise, hunters and landowners having to have a compromise. And if there's one day that you don't hunt out there, it would be Sunday and the landowner gets to use their land.
Oh, I see. So that's where you see that as the compromise. Can the landowner hunt on Sunday?
No.
Nobody can hunt on Sunday. I didn't remember Maine being so puritanic.
Definitely Maine and Massachusetts, and it kind of goes back to the old colonial days.
Yeah, for sure.
And it's interesting because there's been a lot of push in the last couple of years about Sunday hunting, and from our perspective, we look at it as like, hey, listen, I mean, we try to compromise. We're all using other people's property to do this, and that's a fair compromise. If we continue to do that and we don't have reverse posting, if it's still implied access, I think that's a fair compromise between the hunters and the landowners.
That's really interesting. Well, I think the other thing that is different, and you've already implied that, is that you don't, and correct me if I'm wrong, it seems to me that the hunting pressure is very different there than it is here.
Yeah, I mean, our deer population is definitely not as robust as what you would see in Wisconsin, because obviously we do have agricultural land, but it's not as prevalent. It's heavily forested. So, and we're on the northern fringe of whitetail habitat. So our deer population is not as robust, but it's a different type of hunting, where a lot of tracking goes on in the northern part. And the southern part is more where we live. It's a little bit more agriculture. It's probably more comparable to what you're hunting out there with the rolling hills and stuff.
Yeah. I guess the other comparison I would make between the two states is we have a very different hunting and deer situation in southern Wisconsin than we do in northern Wisconsin. Northern Wisconsin is big woods, right? And when I address some of these deer hunting and access issues, I say this pretty often, and it seems like it applies there too. I have a real good feel for what's happening in southern Wisconsin and other parts of the country that are similar to this. I talk to a lot of folks in different states who have, you know, there's similar situations and parts of it. But northern Wisconsin's another world. It's big woods. The deer population is much less. There's gray wolves. The habitat is just, you know, it's a lot of old growth, and, you know, it's not been, I wouldn't say it's not been well managed, but it's not been managed for deer. I think it's, the forestry management is pretty darn good up there, but I'm sure there are people who would argue with me about that too. But and the land ownership is different also. And so I'm not really talking about, you know, northern Maine or northern Wisconsin or even northern Minnesota or northern Michigan and some of those places. I am really talking about, let me give you an example. Southwest Wisconsin, in my county, Richland County, our post-hunt, pre-fawn estimate was 65 deer per square mile of habitat. 85% of this county is deer habitat. Because of chronic wasting disease, we have pockets of the county where the deer population is crashing. The age structure is very young. Deer aren't getting older, and now they're seeing what we were warned of. We're beginning to see that. So again, that's like another one of these factors that goes into this whole thing. And I know we're concentrating on deer hunting here, But this is another one of those factors that kind of enters into this. As a landowner, be prepared to be shocked. On our, we own 430, and then I have the 150 acres next door. So whatever that ends up to be, 580, 600 acres-ish, you know, with a little bit of extra. We killed 40 deer on that property last year. $10, 30 antlerless, six of which were nubbin bucks. 2 weeks after the season, we flew a drone over that same thing and counted 200 deer. So,
wow.
Yeah. So but we're in the northern part of the county. We have a prevalence of CWD positives in bucks about 60%. It's about 30% in does, and we haven't had any fawns yet. Yet being the operative word. So we have this high population. We have a disease that spreads deer to deer. South of us, you can see the dominoes falling. And when I say south of us, I mean less than 20 miles. So you can see these dominoes falling, and all of that landscape is connected, right? As a deer habitat, 85% of the county's deer habitat. In those high population areas, when the disease was first growing in prevalence down there, the younger deer were still getting kicked out. So where are they going? They're coming up here. Well, knowing what I know and the work that I've done with chronic wasting disease, which you may also be aware of, and my perspective and experience with it, for sure one of the things that we wanted to do was to reduce the deer population, not only for disease control, but for habitat management as well. That's just not a sustainable number of deer.
Right.
Because of the amount of agriculture we have, it's sort of feast or famine. And in the wintertime, all of a sudden the fields are, you know, empty of crops, they're in the woods. And so what are they browsing on? They're browsing on all our native woody species, and any kind of oak regeneration in their favorite species are getting mowed off. And then those are all replaced by invasive species like multiflora rose and autumn olive and honeysuckle and Japanese barberry and all this stuff. And because they don't prefer those, right? If they'd eat the invasives, they'd be all right. But so I, as a landowner, then said, well, wait a minute. I one day shot seven does on my farm and just sat in a blind, and just everyone that came out, I shot them. Another one come out, I'd shoot it. Well, if you've ever shot that many animals in an afternoon and then field dressed them and then loaded them in the back of a truck, and then I hung two up for myself to butcher, and I took five to our venison donation program. If you've ever done that, you realize how much work that is. That's one of the things. It's a lot of work. The other part of it was I was a deer exterminator, and I like white-tailed deer. I love white-tailed deer and white-tailed deer hunting and just having them in the landscape. And so I don't ever want to feel like I'm exterminating them. And so the light bulb again kind of went off. Well, how can we, how can I have an impact on that sort of thing? So I started welcoming people to my farm, more people to my farm. We'd already had the group. The stuff that you saw on Meat Eater, we've always done that. Heck, on those episodes that you saw, the first one, the first one was a solo show, and then there were two with Rogan and Callan, and then two with Helen and Brittany. There were six other people hunting that weren't on camera. It was my brother and my nephew and my cousin and a family friend and, you know, a couple family friends. But then after 3 or 4 days, those folks all go home, you know? And so it becomes a question, well, how do you get more deer killed? And then how do you decide who's going to be the person that you're going to allow on there, right? One, I saw that those folks, that giving people that opportunity as their as a contribution to conservation. So that's what this is all, you know, kind of boiling down to. What are you doing for conservation? You know, you've heard this phrase a whole bunch of times, I'm sure. Hunting is conservation. Well, that ain't necessarily so. Hunting, first and foremost, is extraction, right? I mean, the actual act of going out and killing something and taking it, you're extracting, no matter what it is. I mean, if you're hunting, mushrooms, or if you're fiddleheading, or you're a fiddleheader, those kinds of, you're taking something from nature. So what my question always is, what's the land getting out of that? And that might be that it is that Leopold sensibility that I grew up around. I mean, Leopold Shack is 30 miles from me over to the east here. And his Riley Game Cooperative was about 60 miles to the south. And that, of course, was one of the inspirations for our whole sharing the land idea. So as a landowner, I want to be comfortable with the people that I allow onto my property. I would like them to make a contribution to conservation. And I also would like to give opportunity to those folks who might not have as much opportunity as, you know, I've got a lot of friends around here who'd be happy and have hunted my farm. Well, they've got plenty of places to hunt. You know, it's not like they don't have a place to go. And I actually had the experience in turkey hunting where I gave permission to a couple of friends to hunt one of the turkey seasons. And afterwards I said, so how did it go? And they said, oh, we didn't go on your place. What do you mean you didn't go there? Well, we went over to Joe's and Bob's and, you know, and so they got their turkeys. And I said, well, wait a minute. I told other people they couldn't hunt on our place because I'd already given you guys permission. So you were just like stockpiling places to go. And I don't blame them, but I was like, okay, that's another one of these things that I put into this mix in this whole idea. So allowing access to people who, one, are making a contribution to conservation, who are thinking about conservation, and who don't necessarily have another place to go or have an opportunity. And those are some of the themes of sharing land, right? So who are those folks? Well, it's a lot of urbanites aged 25 to 40, you know, those emerging hunters, that biggest demographic in the growth of hunting. And so all of these things we've really learned in the last year and a half, 2 years since we've started sharing the land. It's like, who is our audience? Who are our landowner audience? Who is our who are our access seekers going to be? Which land are we going to get on or be able to get on? Who's open to this? And then who's interested in it? And it's really the newer hunters and emerging hunters and the folks that it seems like there's a lot of energy being expended recruiting, reactivating, and retaining hunters. We know that two of the biggest impediments to hunting are having someone to go with and then having a place to go. So all of those things are a part of sharing the land.
This is the Talking Trash segment, where we're going to talk about illegal dumping as one of the leading causes of private land being shut down for public access. Crappy situation. This spring, the Maine Forest Service contacted the Maine Warden Service Landowner Relations and informed them of an incident at a privately owned woodlot in Cornville, Maine, involving numerous plastic buckets dumped with human feces. Although not common, this is not the first time the Maine Warden Service and Maine Forest Service have encountered illegal dumping of human feces. In 2015, yours truly discovered adult diapers dumped in Homer, Home Depot buckets, in Temple Stream, in Temple, Maine, and Farmington, Maine. The underlying question, first, who defecates in buckets? Second, who litters them on other people's property and across the beautiful landscape of the state of Maine? Without question, littering or illegal dumping is the one, if not the leading cause of land being closed to the public. Without a doubt, if someone dumped poop on my property, I would close it down. With the assistance of a local septic pumping company, the feces were removed from the private landowner's property. If you have any information in regards to these illegal dumping cases, please contact your local authorities. Reporting this illegal activity will allow us to continue catching the intentional violator as we continue to fight for public access. As William Stack said from Unsolved Mysteries, join me. Perhaps you may be able to solve a mystery.
With your property, Doug, have you, like, this was the kind of poster child for sharing the land. Like, what other property owners, I know that you said that you do some land management and for other people and stuff. Do you have other property owners that have jumped on board with you?
Yeah, we actually have 30 properties now in 8 different states, and which is a little, wasn't really the original intention, right? The original intention was, let's try to do more in this area where we're at.
Right.
And I do have, seeing all their faces in my mind's eye right now. We have 4 properties in this area. And what's been really interesting about it is that I've had people come up to me and say, this whole sharing the land thing. Well, it's not like that's new. I've been letting people hunt in my place for years. I'm like, great. Can we tell that story? And I don't just hear that in my part of the state or in my part of the country, but we're here or in this region, but I'm hearing that in different places around the country. And so it seems like we've heard so much about private land access being a problem, yet there's all kinds of successes out there and there's all kinds of great examples. So, you know, let's do that. So we have 30 different properties in 8 different states. We have, just looking at the latest numbers here, it looks like we're over 350 access seekers. So we're still, supply outpaces demand, right? And then the other thing that's really strange is like we get these 2 really cool landowners in North Dakota. And this is a great example. These guys signed up when we were at Pheasant Fest and, you know, big upland, prairie chickens and pheasants and upland game bird hunting up there. You know, and some deer hunting and stuff, but much more known for the bird hunting, which people are super into. And so these guys are signing up some pretty big parcels and they're needing help with, you know, planting native shrubs and, you know, repairing some fence or taking out some fence that has been problematic or, you know, just, you know, cleaning up trails. And I mean, there's all these things. And suddenly we've got 2 big landowners up there and we got North Dakota, man. Nobody lives up there. So, you know, there's like, I don't know, 750,000 people in the whole darn state. And so we literally put a call out for people in North Dakota. And the cool thing is those landowners also said, well, you know, they don't have to be from around here. If there are people who are willing to make the trip and come up here for a weekend in the spring or summer and help us, and then they want to come back for a weekend in the fall to hunt, we're into that. And so that, you know, so it's just like I use this expression all the time. We are building this bicycle as we're riding it, you know, so we're really adapting and changing and adding different ideas all the time. And that's, but because we're starting with a philosophy, right? And I think that's kind of the biggest part of any of this sort of thing, certainly the conservation work that I'm involved with. If you can start with the philosophy is that we are going to be conservation-based, cooperative-based, and community-based, that all the rest of that can get figured out, right? So we had the same experience, as I said, down in Missouri. Down in Missouri, big landowner down there, but man, nobody around him. And so he's kind of doing the same thing. Now, I have a list as long as your arm of people who want to hunt on my farm. And we've had some good success with some other landowners around here as well. So it's been a real interesting process. And I guess I would, if you'd like, I'll tell you a little bit about the process.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you go on the Sharing the Land website and it's sharingtheland.com. And if you're a landowner, you'll go on there and you'll click on something called the Cooperating Land Profile or Land Profile. It's a fillable form that you can go on and you click on it. And you'll fill out information about your property and yourself and all of that. And that comes to us. So it comes to my email and my assistant's email. We don't share that information with anyone. But then there's also another thing. If you're an access seeker, it's called a conservation resume. Sound familiar, right? I mean, after all, when you're trying to gain access to something, you're really trying to present yourself in a way, right? So people go on and they fill out the conservation resume, and I've had people, you know, email me and say, yeah, geez, but I don't have much to put on my conservation resume because I don't know much. And so how do I, well, part of that is what are your intentions and what kind of person are you? Tell them about your learn to hunt experience. Tell them about, so now all of a sudden we're encouraging people to join some of these organizations, to go to field days, to learn about conservation work. And then, as I said, some of the landowners, they just need help like cleaning up their trails or, limming trees, which isn't manned space flight. That's a big project that we've done on my place where I've just given people loppers and we're going out and limbing our pine trees and things like that. So some of the skills that you have, we have a list of things, but it's encouraging people to build that resume then also, right? What I found to be really interesting is that landowners have, and I'm like this too, where some of them, it's like, well, geez, that guy's got, or that gal has, this skill, that's something that I could really use around the place. On the other hand, this person is a new hunter or someone who's new to conservation. I'm really interested in having someone like that around too, who you can help develop. And so what we've seen, I thought it was, to me, that was just my sensibility. But what we've seen is other landowners have been interested in having a mix of people also. So that kind of goes back to community and cooperation base. So that's really simply the process. Those conservation resumes come to us. We sort them, we've got a sorting mechanism that tells us where these people are and where they're interested in going. And then we send however many resumes that the landowner is interested in, we send those to them, and then they make the contact. And we've got some guidelines and frequently asked questions and, answers about liability, which is one of the biggest things, right? And how you can get insured for that. And then there's an agreement that they can, if they choose to have people sign, with a hold harmless clause in it. And so we do as much as we can to help them mitigate that. But once we send them that stuff, that's pretty much between them and the access seeker. So what we really are is a meeting place. We're kind of a, it seems weird to say, but I
coffee
suppose,
shop. You're the coffee shop.
Yeah. So, the old diner where you'd run into people. I mean, I've done that plenty of times. And, you start talking about why you're there. And then people are like, oh, yeah, well, we got a place out here. It's simply another way. I'm a big fan of the voluntary public access programs through the Farm Bill. I'm a big fan of public land. I'm okay with leasing. In fact, I lease our farm to some bow hunters for the first part of the bow season, or the best part of the bow season, they'd say. But I always say that bow hunting's for people who don't have enough to do. So it's not, as a farm kid, it's not something that I ever did or ever got into. We were always gun hunters. I never could understand that, sitting in a tree for days at a time waiting for a hapless deer to come by. I like go after them. It's like you were talking about out in Maine where there's a lot of tracking and that sort of stuff goes on. On our acreage, we do a lot of still hunting and mooching, we call it. So which I like to kind of force the issue a little more than sitting and waiting for this hapless love-struck buck or doe to come walking by. But so I actually lease our farm for a short period of time to these guys to bow hunt it. And that keeps my partners, who are my siblings, happy because there's some revenue. But then they're like, whatever you want. I think I said we killed 40 deer on our farm last year. That was 40 different hunters. Four of them are a part of our lease, and the other 36, there's six of us who are family and friends. And so the other 30 were people who were invited through either sharing the land or we've done a bunch of learn to hunts on our property, both through sharing the land, but then also with some of our sponsors like Vortex Optics came out and did a learn to hunt day. And it's literally sharing land. I mean, it's something.
It's funny, too, because I know that you were talking about landowner liability. And in Maine, we are very fortunate where we have a landowner liability law that allows people, a landowner, to allow people to access their property where they're not liable. So if they allow a snowmobile trail, ATV trail, or they allow you to hunt on your property, then they're not liable if you get hurt out there, which is very rare. Like, there's not many states that have that. But that is one of the big things here that we've are very lucky to have because we have the access that we do.
Yeah.
And I know, too, like, yeah. It's one of the best in the nation that I know of.
Recreational access law. They're sort of a standard form. And the interesting thing to me is that more states are doing that. I don't know that I need to look more closely at Maine's, but Wisconsin has a recreational access law as well. And there's some flaws with it. But one of them that's really interesting is you can actually take up to a certain amount of value as well, and still be covered under that. It only makes sense, right? You're being a really good Samaritan if you're allowing access. You shouldn't be liable. People are out there with guns or out there with an ATV or a UTV or whatever, people need to be able to, or should assume a certain amount of liability. But interestingly, we've also been working with American Hunting Lease Association, and which you can imagine, American Hunting Lease Insurance Association or Hunting Lease Insurance. I can't remember exactly what the acronym is, but it's on our website. It's a pretty low cost thing to have both liability insurance for people accessing for hunting or other recreation, for a landowner to have that. It's called vacant land insurance. And if you're in a situation where you develop a co-op like we do, that co-op becomes the lessee, or like a lessee. This sprung up because of leasing. And, for $250 to $300 a year, you can have $1 million liability coverage. So I think all of those things, we're mitigating as much of the liability as we can. As I said, we have a whole harmless agreement as well. But there's a whole bunch of sort of like the access thing I was just talking about. We've got public land. We've got voluntary public access programs with all the walk-in programs, which are a big part of the West, right? And here we're trying to add another part. I can tell you this, at least in my part of the country and some of the other parts of the country that we've been working, is that engaged landowners are not interested in an unrestricted access program. The unrestricted public access is just doesn't work in parts of the country for a few different reasons. One, leasing is, access is highly valuable. So consequently, people are, and paper companies are one of them. In Northern New Hampshire, one of the things that started I don't know why I keep saying Northern New Hampshire, but Northern Wisconsin, one of the things that started changing is that the big pump paper companies who own pieces of property up there started, they're like, well, wait a minute, we can make X amount of dollars a year on leasing. This is an asset that needs to have return on investment. The cost of ownership is going up. This is something that we're going to do too. And again, that's a dynamic that's changed over the last 30 or 40 years. And so leasing has become a part of hunting, for better or worse. And, I get in these discussions with people all the time and say, well, it's the people's game. I was like, yeah, but the land isn't.
And it's funny you say that, because in Maine, it's state law that it's illegal to have a hunting lease. So
really?
You can't have a hunting lease in the state of Maine, because similar to what you're saying, where the game is owned by the people of the state. So we actually have a law in place that doesn't allow for a hunting specific lease.
But you can lease land for other purposes. That sounds I was going to say
there's always a gray area, right? There's always a loophole.
Yeah. Well, and that's just it. And so I'm not interested in we had that happen here with our managed forest law program where there were these various restrictions, and the managed forest law is a forest management, private land forest management program that was supposed to encourage access. And what it really did was punish you if you didn't allow access. And then there was a lot of concern about that, legitimate concerns like, wait a minute, hunting is not guaranteed by the Constitution. Private property rights are. And so how do we, and I would say that your law would probably be declared unconstitutional at some point. And like you said, there's a way of being able to get around that sort of stuff. So you can lease, it's an interesting thing, right? I'm guessing that you could lease the farmland.
You could say a gate fee, or like it's not illegal to charge a gate fee or anything right. like that. It's just the fee for wildlife. There's a law prohibiting that.
I like that. I like that idea. I mean, don't get me wrong. I like that idea, but it kind of goes back to the access thing. There's implied access. So do I
one of the things,
go ahead.
One of the things too, Doug, I wanted to ask you about is like in here in Maine, like we have a large, litter problem would be the best way of putting it. Mm. And one of the events that we hold on a yearly basis is our annual landowner cleanup day. It's our appreciation day for landowners that allow access. And on average, we clean up about 37 ton of trash in one day, about 700 tires statewide. And I was kind of wondering if you see similar issues with some of your landowners that you deal with, or what types of programs that your access seekers are doing with landowners to help them out. I know that you mentioned doing some tree trimming and stuff like that, or like having simple tools like that. But do you see the litter on your side as well that people are having issues with as landowners?
That's one of the, but you see that mostly in the ditches and then the public access areas or the open private land.
Yeah.
Whereas on the closed private land, you don't see that problem.
Yeah.
I mean, you want to turn a landowner off from allowing unrestricted public access, throw some garbage out there. There's a couple of EPA lands near us that I go by and I never hunt them because, I have my own land, but I'll go there and walk them or, check for mushrooms and stuff like that. And invariably, man, there'll be tires and other trash there. I pick up more crap on those kinds of places than I sure do on my own. We have a highway that goes through our farm, so that's different. But, there's a real ethic involved with that, right? And that's a part of what we're trying to help encourage and develop in these folks is, well, why would you, not only should you pick it up, why would you throw it there in the first place? I mean, who's throwing it there in the first place, right?
Right.
And if the reward for a private landowner is, who's allowing access, is to find a bunch of garbage on their land, it's going to be hard to keep them with that. I know folks out in Montana are doing similar things. That it's landowner appreciation stuff. And I think that I'll be 65 in January. I think that my generation had sort of unfettered access for a long time, right? And had a different, I'm trying not to be too hard on my generation and be encouraging of yours. That it was just a different ethic. Heck, I remember, everything was in bottles and stuff when I was a kid, and then plastics became this big thing, and now plastics are, it's just a mess. Plastics are just a mess. I don't find glass and stuff like that. I find plastic in the ditches. What's the cool thing is that people will come in from hunting, and if they found something like a Mylar balloon, which is just like one of the worst darn things, they bring it in and they tell me about it, right? But on our private, on our closed private lands, trash isn't as much of an issue. So
I think too, like, I mean, you and I mean, we have a pretty good understanding of what private access is to land, and like we have an understanding of how fragile that is, because like you were just saying, like, I mean, it's a different, I mean, my generation versus your generation, but I've always kind of felt like it's so fragile that we're always on this teeter-totter of losing that. And I mean, what are some of the ways that you think that you'd like to carry this message forward to access seekers who maybe aren't as quite aware of that? Like, what would be the things that you would say to them to try to keep it going forward?
Well, one is, no matter what you're talking about in I think in life, and this is an old man talking to you now, kids. I think it's important to develop and to think about what your philosophy is. Am I a taker? Am I a giver? Am I a balancer? My conservation motto is, it's not ours, it's just our turn. And I have the good fortune of managing and being this generation's steward of 120 acre or of a 400 acre farm that's been in my family for 120 years. So that was an easy connection for me, right? But that's really my conservation philosophy and my family's conservation philosophy. And it's not ours, it's just our turn has become a motto that other people have picked up on. We're honoring and learning from the past while we plan and implement in the present to do the best we can for the future. I would encourage folks to think about what their philosophy is. Well, I'm just going to be a user. Well, I'd like to think if people start thinking about that they would say, you know, maybe that's not the best way to be. You know, of course, we all want to know what we're going to get out of it. I grew up in, you know, John F. Kennedy was president when I was a really little kid. And he said, you know, ask not what your country can do for you, but what you can do for your country. As I said before, hunting is extraction. Let's think about what it is when we're taking something. What are we putting back into it? You know, Eldo Leopold said that when we see ourselves as a member of the biotic community, we will treat that community more lovingly. And boy, if we've seen anything in the last, since I was a kid, which you say a lot as you get older, it's that our resources are not finite. Our resources need to be managed. And if we can not just think about what I'm getting out of this, but what I'm giving to it and how I'm a part of a bigger community, and how I can cooperate within a community, I think we'll be in a better place. And here's the other part of that. It's more fun. This whole Sharing the Land initiative and the work that we're doing and the gatherings that we're having, like our Doe Derby, which is a whole other thing, but it's just so much fun to be part of a community and bring people into it and welcome people into it, as opposed to a more selfishness, which I hate to say it, but that's a little bit of what happened in my generation in the outdoors and in hunting. It's like, oh, the whole jealousy of a big buck or any of that sort of stuff. Like somehow this is proving your mettle as a hunter or a person. I had the good fortune of growing up with a father who really, I remember the first hunting lesson I got from him when he was telling me about deer hunting before I got to go was, you know, you're also out there hunting for the other guy. And we say other person now, but in those days it was the other guy, right? The other person, and that whole idea of cooperation and community, and how much fun those guys had together, how much fun we're having together with these Sharing the Land things. This is one of the coolest things. I was just at a meeting out in Bozeman that Meteor put together, and there were 40 people from around the country. We were all there for one particular conservation discussion. And we went around the room, and these are heavy hitters in the conservation and outdoor industry world. And The facilitator said, let's all, you know, introduce ourselves, you know, the shtick, right? And then what hunt you're looking forward to this year? Not one person in that 40 said, I'm really looking forward to going out hunting by myself. They all talked about who they were going with, about that shared experience, about the community part of it, you know, in one form or another. So I don't remember what your original question was here at the end, but that's philosophically, those are the things I think if we think about that, then we don't have to get so much into specifics. You know, so the specifics work themselves out.
Absolutely. And Doug, I want to thank you very much for taking the time out of your busy schedule. I know that you got a lot going on and working on the farm and doing all the outreach that you're doing right now. And I know here in Maine, we are very fortunate to have what we have here, and we're very lucky to have the access that we do. And just like you telling your story out there today with our viewers and getting the word out there that it's not ours, it's just our turn here. And if we can kind of all work together and get that word out there, that we'll always have the access that we do. Because like you said, I mean, without the access, we can't do the conservation work that we have to do. Our department can't do the conservation work that we want to do. And that's why I got into this job originally. I went to the University of Maine with a wildlife ecology degree and came out of it thinking that my best way to serve the public was to get in the law enforcement side of it and become a game warden in the state of Maine, which worked out pretty well for me. So I very much appreciate your time and really appreciate you sharing the word of conservation out there.
Well, thank you. And I plan to get back out to Maine again. I've got some dear friends in the Brownfield area. Sometimes I wonder why the heck I ever left out there, but you know.
No, we'd love to have you out here. If you're ever out here, let me know.
I certainly will. Certainly will. So thanks for having me. Yeah.
Thank you for tuning in and learning more about the Sharing the Land initiative. Be sure to check out Doug's website at sharingtheland.com. I hope you will join me again next week as I talk with landowner and Snowmobile Club President Joe Cruzzi to learn how businesses are coming together to serve the community. You might be surprised to learn how much work goes into keeping snowmobile trails open in Maine. In the meantime, do your part to help protect Maine's tradition of access to private land by being a responsible land user and showing your appreciation and support for Maine's private landowners.